Millen Audio presents Upstate by James Wood. Read for you by Raphael Corkhill. Chapter 1. First, he would have to go and see his mother. He would tell her something about Vanessa, not everything, of course. The home, 6 miles along a favorite road, was a formidable old place, with that gray strictness of the north he loved. But now it looked abandoned. Everything was in wintry abeyance. 4 years she had been living there, and he was still never sure how to announce himself. It was also ridiculously expensive. He could no longer afford it. What did she, what did he, get for the money? 2 small rooms rather than 1? Extra space for the dark massing of a lifetime's heavy old furniture? And maybe she got 2 biscuits with her tea on Fridays. He made his way through 2 huffing fire doors, which bottled a weekend's stale yeast. School food. Outside his mother's room, Clarendon, he gathered himself a bit like a clown, pulling up his trousers, dusting down his coat, and entered with a light knock. The television was off, thank goodness. She was asleep in the chintz chair his father had used as the family throne, issuing directives and decrees from behind his newspaper. She was tiny, sunken, some of her teeth were out. The old music hall joke. Her teeth are like stars, they come out at night. But it was early afternoon. As she breathed, something seemed to catch in her throat. She'd always had a large nose, and now she seemed to be reducing around it, shrinking down to bone, the nose tenacious, final, root-like. I have hers, so this will be mine, right enough. He knelt beside her and whispered. She opened her eyes and said with slight affront, "When did you get here, Helen?" As if he'd been spying on her. "Just a second ago. Fetch me my teeth. By the side of the bed, please, in the glass." She turned away from him to insert the plate. "No, we need to call for some tea and biscuits. They'll bring it, if you ask." As a child, in a lower middle-class suburb of Edinburgh, she had made herself unpopular at school by affecting an English, or maybe Anglo-Scots pronunciation. Since his dad's death, her accent seemed to have moved up the ranks again by another notch or two. It usually had the effect of making her sound slightly irritable. In truth, these days she sounded like the mistress, but looked more like the servant. Short, bent, too modestly or shabbily dressed today. "You don't need to wear this shawl thing, do you?" he said, lifting it over her shoulders. "Certainly not. I just put it on for my nap. Thank you. You look very tired. You know, you can't burn your candle at both ends." A Roman candle, maybe? He had just had his 68th birthday. "How are you?" "All right, I suppose. But this English view isn't my landscape, of course," she added, gesturing at the window with splendid authority. "Well, it's not a bad one," he said, looking at the line of leafless trees and the icy hills. He was paying for that English view. "And we've been over this. You don't want to live with me. You need your independence, though it would be a lot cheaper if you did move in with us." "Absolutely not. I took in your grandmother, as you perfectly well know, and it made my 50s a complete blank. All I did, day after day, was look after her. I'll never do that to you." In that house, the two women had seemed to detest each other. With stealthy expertise, each made the other immovably depressed. "But you want me to visit, and I want to visit you." He took her hand. "You're no good to me 3 hours away up in Scotland, even though you'd have your own landscape there," he said it gently. The tea arrived, carried by a very red teenage boy. He offered a biscuit to both of them, and then left, making sure to take the full plate with him. "Wartime rations around here," said his mother. The young man appeared again. Mrs. Querry, he said, I'm supposed to remind you that the residents are gathering at 3:30 in the Sun Lounge for the winter flu vaccination. It's, you know, the booster for them that missed it first time round. Need any help? No, I have my son. Thank you. The room could have been a lot worse. High ceilings with ornate mouldings, Roman laurels almost, textured wallpaper with chips in it like slivered almonds. Though in fact these always made him think of splinters caught under a child's skin, all painted a pleasant cream. And parental things he had known all his life, a watercolour reproduction of Durham Cathedral, an antique mirror that you couldn't really see yourself in. It looked valuable, but he knew it wasn't. A cushion whose faded lilac cover, bought by him at Heels, London on the Tottenham Court Road, had not been replaced in 30 years at least. It was all pretty good, or as good as can be when one's whole life has been reduced to souvenirs of selfhood. It was a nice place, but he couldn't afford it any longer. She looked at him with her pale blue eyes. Vanessa's.
This whole place is up in arms. My next-door neighbour lost her hearing aid yesterday. She put it in some tissue paper on her bedside table, and the cleaner threw it out by mistake. She thought it was a bit of rubbish. And in the room that's just 2 doors down the hall, Mary Benet is furious because she likes to talk French to another woman here who can understand it. She's the only woman who can. And now Mary's been told to stop talking French by the staff. Apparently someone else, we all assume it's one of the residents, and I have a very good idea who, has complained that they're speaking a secret language to exclude everyone else. I'll miss it. I couldn't understand what they were saying, but I liked hearing the French. And now the manager is leaving at the end of the month. She's only been here for 6 months. She's Czech, I think. A nice woman, though for some reason she hates to be thought of as Polish. He interrupted her. Ma, I have to go to America for a week. America? Well, on business.
She had always enjoyed enunciating those words, so he spoke them back to her with finality. On business.
Well, don't get caught up in anything.
Caught up in anything?
It's a dangerous place from what I hear. There was that terrible thing with the towers. You'll go and see Vanessa. She always wanted you to visit her in that place.
In Saratoga Springs?
Yes, I wanted to say Sarsaparilla.
I will see her. And Josh?
Oh, good Lord, courage there. He's far too young, and certainly not good enough for her.
You've never even met him.
Yes, that's two of us. But I do have a telephone here, you know. I get reports. And I was about to say, before you interrupted me, that Vanessa isn't getting any younger, is she?
Ma, I can't keep up with you. Now you're giving him your blessing.
Well, why shouldn't the poor thing have a boyfriend? Maybe Josh is the one. And when they marry, you'll blame him for taking Vanessa away.
Oh, Vanessa was already away. Well away. She did a PhD there, not here after all. That was the beginning.
Silly girl. It was a shame she didn't come back at Christmas. I suppose she'd rather spend time with her beau.
There was a moment or two of old-fashioned silence, the tick of his mother's fancy carriage clock, his gift.
Alan, love, can you help me to the sunroom? I want to get there early, while the needle is still sharp.
They smiled at each other, and he helped her up and went beside her as she gripped the mouse-grey tubular walker, a marvel of engineering, as strong as a weightlifter but as light as the bones of a very old lady, with wheels on the front and 2 splayed yellow tennis balls stuck on the back legs. These dragged along the carpet as the aged couple, mother and son, moved slowly down the corridor. Chapter 2. The house of Querry certainly looked good, as if it were built on rock rather than sand. A curved gravel path, as he drove up it now, his car tires ground and displaced the little blanched pebbles in an expensive flurry, Ample stones, tall windows, a black metal S to keep some sagging stonework together, a stout old front door, a bent black iron boot scraper, the kind you could never buy, only inherit. It was circa 1860. Alan Querry hadn't built it, but sometimes felt as if he had. Here, he and Kathy had brought up Vanessa and Helen, and here he had raised them after Kathy walked out. Here was the window he'd replaced, on his own, there the guttering he'd fixed, on his own, there the garage roof he'd replaced with the help of Rob, the slightly retarded odd-job man from the village. It looked like the place of someone who had done well for himself. He lived in the poshest part of Northumberland, where all the neighbours, if that was the word for people so richly distant, seemed to be gentlemen farmers. They had all boarded at Eton, and strode around the county wearing those rust-coloured baggy corduroys, tired but glowing somehow, like the embers of old money. Where did they get those old but very expensive new clothes? New in Lingwood, German Street, London. He had once shopped there himself, triumphant but sweaty in the hushed emporium. His nearest neighbour was a balding, middle-aged baronet, a gentle but unremarkable chap who had done nothing at all in his life, and whose only distinction, celebrated in the area, was that he read The Shining when it was first published, and was so scared he'd been unable to sleep for 3 whole days and nights. It wasn't Alan's world. His father left school at 16 and went into the shipbuilding industry in Newcastle. Da was clever and industrious, and was soon working at Parsons, buying parts for their great steam turbines. Alan was born in Newcastle. After the war, the Querry family moved to Durham, and Da eventually opened a big hardware shop there, on Sadler Street, on the way up to the cathedral. His father had truly established himself, not just a shopkeeper, but a proprietor, whose name was proverbial in town. "I'm popping into Querry's." Da never made more of it than that, though. It was seeing his father try and fail to expand, try and fail to acquire a second shop, that gave Alan the idea of going into property, first in Durham, then in Newcastle, York, Manchester. Their only child liked making enough money of his own to buy his parents a brand new Volvo, the only new car they ever owned, and to pay his dad's hospice bills when the end came. Now he was paying his mum's bills, and he couldn't afford it, and no one, least of all Helen and Vanessa, would believe him when he told them this. It would be incomprehensible to them. How could the Querry Property Group, with buildings throughout the north of England, even a shiny, but it was only one room, new office in Manchester, and a fancy website designed by an American firm from Salt Lake City, how could all that not keep on paying and paying? He walked across the gravel and pushed open the heavy front door. Otter jumped from his basket, writhing with pleasure. He hadn't seen Candace's car at the front, so perhaps she was out. There was no one in the kitchen, nor in the expensively subdued sitting room. The French windows glowed. The short February afternoon was sloping away. It was very still. For so many years, after Kathy left, and after the children went off to university, the house had seemed desperately quiet. The thick carpet held the ghost of their footsteps. He even thought about selling the beautiful old place. Candace had changed all that. His daughters, Helen especially, didn't much like her. Among other things, they found her free market anti-communism strident. Well, he didn't like Candace's politics that much. He'd always been reflexively Labour. Everyone in Durham was, even the successful ones who got away. Maybe they were jealous as they got older and greyer and wider, as they waned, Vanessa's coinage, combining wan and wan, jealous of her still black hair, straight and glossy, her trim hips, her formidable vitality. The only time he'd seriously attempted to get his daughters together with Candace, they argued about whether Mrs. Thatcher had been a net benefit to the country, Candace's brisk conclusion, or a bloody disaster, Helen's. Vanessa later said she found Candace coercive. Van had sulked like a child and retreated to her bedroom, he now recalled. Whatever Vanessa and Helen felt about the situation, he had been saved by Candace, that he was sure about.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.